Penguin Random House Audio presents Triage on Reading, Writing, and the Interior Life. This is the author, Richard Russo. Chapter 1. I was once asked in an interview, "What's the best thing about being a storyteller?" "That's easy," I replied. "You get to cheat. To live many lives, not just the one you're born to." "Ah," the interviewer nodded, understanding perfectly. "So it's the same as reading." "Yes, exactly. Your interior life, where time and space operate differently. The life in your head, or perhaps your soul. The most private place you have, that you never show in its entirety to anyone. For some, and not without reason, it's a place to steer clear of. And to the extent that you're able to manage, that inner life can seem almost vestigial. For others, it's a place of strength and solace. For a few, artists in particular, it's the whole point of living. Chapter 2. For most Americans, the coronavirus became real in March 2020, but I will always think of it as beginning earlier, in January, because that's when paralyzing fear unexpectedly entered my life and took up what feels like permanent residence in my psyche. I was in New York City, visiting with friends and meeting with my publisher, when my cell rang at 3 in the morning. Never a good sign. It was my older daughter, Emily. "Dad," she said, her voice shaking, "can you come home?" She was calling from the emergency room at Maine Medical Center in Portland, where her little boy, Henry, then 7, my grandson, was in critical condition. 45 minutes earlier, he had appeared at his parents' bedside demanding his inhaler. He'd taken a blast before going to bed, so it was too soon for another. Groggy with sleep, Emily and her husband Steve might have told him to go back to bed, that he could have another hit first thing in the morning. There are times when every parent has to make critical decisions without understanding in the moment that they are, in fact, critical. Probably they were still on high alert because Henry was getting over a case of the flu. No small thing for a kid with asthma. What they didn't know was that while they were asleep, he'd had a violent coughing fit and collapsed a lung. Had they just sent him back to bed, he might have died. I wasn't the only one who was away at the time. Barbara, my wife, was in Arizona visiting family. My younger daughter, Kate, and her husband, Tom, both of whom also live in Portland, happened to be in New York as well, though they had an early flight home that morning. I was supposed to be in town for a couple more days, but after hanging up with Emily, I called the airline and booked the last seat on the same flight Kate and Tom were on, then called Barbara so she could start making arrangements to return home as well. The last thing I tossed into my suitcase before checking out of my hotel was the small plastic bottle of nasal spray I had set on the nightstand when I checked in. There's another on my bedside table at home, and a spare in the medicine cabinet. Wherever I am, there's always one nearby in case I wake up with clogged nasal passages. Otherwise, I would have to get dressed and search out an all-night pharmacy. Whoa, you're thinking, seriously? Seriously. Perhaps because I watched my grandfather die of emphysema, the idea of death by asphyxiation is enough to send me into a blind, flop-sweat panic. That's why I wouldn't dream of going anywhere without nasal spray in my travel kit. And why, no matter where I am, there's always one on the nightstand where I can find it in the dark. The thought of Henry, a child, not being able to breathe, and unable to understand why, left me weak in the knees with terror. At 4:30 in the morning, there isn't much traffic in Manhattan, and in a matter of minutes, my taxi was speeding through the Midtown Tunnel. We made it to JFK in record time, but time, as we would all learn later during the pandemic, elongates when mixed with dread. I remember clutching my cell phone the whole way, checking it every few blocks to reassure myself that I hadn't somehow switched the thing off and missed a call from my daughter. Once I boarded my short flight to Portland, the thing would be useless. I tried desperately to banish the thought that by the time I landed in Portland, my grandson might be dead. But since the beginning of time, has any human being ever succeeded in not thinking something that demands to be thought for the simple reason that we cannot bear to think it? Time. Plenty of it on that taxi ride. Even time to enter into negotiations. Take me, not him. Who was I negotiating with? I had no idea. Whoever could deliver. By the time we arrived in Portland and took another taxi to the hospital, Henry was mostly out of danger, his collapsed lung reinflated. Here's a fun fact, though, for those who have never experienced something like this or have blessedly forgotten what it feels like. When the worst doesn't happen, when you are, for some unknown reason, spared what happens to the less fortunate, dread is not vanquished by relief. At least not completely. Because our lizard brains are programmed to prepare us for the worst, fear lingers, metastasizes, issues coded warnings. Okay, mine said, this time you were lucky. But guess what? Now I know right where to find you. Fear. Is it also part of the inner life that's so important to artists? On the face of it, you would think so, but I'm not sure. I suspect that fear, like other powerful feelings, even when it's rendered physical, a plastic bottle of nasal spray, is a gateway drug to the inner life, the thing that starts the conversation. The one that many people, for good reason, try their best to avoid. Chapter 3. Fast forward 18 long months to August 2021. Like many others, I have emerged from lockdown, chastened, but otherwise pretty much unscathed. Thanks to the vaccine I received back in March, I have begun to travel again and to eat indoors at restaurants with vaccinated friends. What I had sensed might be coming for me and mine came instead for others. As the pandemic unfolded, there'd been some cause for alarm. Suddenly, all over the world, men and women the same age as my wife and me were gasping for breath, like Henry had done with his collapsed lung. The high-rise apartment building where we were hunkered down in Portland was, in essence, a vertical cruise ship, and sheltering in place there put me in mind of the aristocrats in Poe's The Mask of the Red Death, who foolishly imagined their many-roomed mansion would protect them from the plague that raged outside, only to discover just how egalitarian death is. Not a few pundits in 2020 tried to convince us of this same lesson, that we were all in the same boat. Well, this, of course, couldn't have been farther from the truth. The vessels we occupied were many and varied. Some were crowded, others leaky. Some capsized in the waves, others simply ran aground. The most fortunate took it all in stride. From the balcony of our high-rise, my wife and I watched the harbor below fill with luxury yachts, their Florida owners drawn by less toxic Maine air. Restaurants, many closed except for takeout, delivered right to their moorings. Thanks to a successful writing career, I too was embarrassingly well positioned to shelter in place.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.